Hi, I'm Martin.
Hi, I'm Sarah.
Hi, I'm Marcus. Welcome to Lund, home of the world's largest low-temperature district heating system.
Lund is home to the world's largest low-temperature district heating system. Operated by local utility Kraftringen, it's part of an energy network incorporating residual heat from Sweden's two largest research facilities, including the European Spallation Source Particle Accelerator. We hit the road to learn more about why this pioneering heating and cooling system is a sustainable model for future urban energy networks.
Martin, thank you so much for welcoming Enlit on the road to Lund. Tell us, why is this district heating facility so special?
The main speciality here is the temperature, because it's lower here. We keep 65 degrees here, whereas we have 100 degrees in the normal district heating system. That has several advantages. One is that we get lower heating losses in the piping.
Yeah.
The second thing is the pipes. Because of a low temperature, we can use plastic instead of steel piping. And that has a few advantages. One is that we don't have to weld every 12 meter that you have to do with steel piping, but instead we get piping on rolls that can be up to 250 meters long. The source of the heat for this low temperature district heating network is the research facility MAX 4. And accelerating electrons requires quite a lot of electricity. Almost all of that electricity has to be cooled off in a very controlled way. Controlled way means water cooling system, means the energy is trapped, easy to recover. So when we first heard about this research facility, we thought that, okay, we want this heat into the district heating system. To recover all this heat, we have, in cooperation with Lund University, installed heat pumps. Heat pumps have a double function. They provide cooling to MAX 4, and then we recover it to a low temperature heating grid, and that makes the heat recovery more efficient. Of course, Lund University always wants this facility to be in operation, so they have been very specific to us about what to install. One particular issue was that they were quite concerned about possible vibration problems. So we have installed, for example, under distribution pumps, we have springs below, and we have installed flexible flanges instead of piping to ensure that we don't get any vibrations from our equipment to their research equipment.
It sounds simple, but I'm sure it's not. What are some of the challenges that you've experienced with this kind of project?
When we started building here, we checked the market, found no plastic pipes that were good enough, basically. So we had a EU project running where we had a supplier develop new types of piping for us. And that, of course, brought along several technical issues. On the organizational issues, so to speak, the heating market is an open market. We cannot be guaranteed that a customer will choose district heating from us. But in the same time, we had to build some of the pipes quite a long way before the buildings came up. So that was a financial challenge. It also made it a bit difficult with the planning issues, because we had to build pipes in areas where the municipality hadn't planned where the roads were going to be built.
Martin, you've obviously overcome these challenges. Tell us about the lessons you've learned.
The most important lesson, I think, is working together with the municipality. It was also a learning procedure for a municipality, because they had never done this before, not on this scale at least. So we have established good cooperation procedures. Talking a lot to the end customers, of course, that's always important.
Sarah, this is not just a district heating project. There's a cooling aspect to this project as well. Tell us about that.
We are here at our newest production facility, Brunnshögsverket, which will be the main production site for the district cooling system here in this region. And this is our new puzzle in creating a smart and flexible and sustainable energy system in Lund. Our main goal was to create an energy system that was sustainable, and no use of PFAS, which is commonly used in refrigerants in the cooling industry, and also to be as resource efficient as possible.
How are you using the recovered heat from ESS and MAX for this particular system?
During the warmer months, we're actually going to have more waste heat than the demand. And this is where our system comes in handy. We have an absorption chiller inside this building, and it's going to use waste heat to produce cooling instead of electricity. Actually, we've been producing district cooling for quite a while in this region, and we're going to connect this site with the already existing district cooling system in the city downtown. And that's going to allow us to optimize operations between several different production units in the entire system every day. And that is going to cost less money, but it's also going to have a lower impact on the environment, and we're going to be able to use more rescued heat waste. And the connection is going to be completed this summer.
Marcus, how does a project like this really inspire future developments in this region?
I think this is, as the world's largest low-temperature district heating system, it is inspiring in itself, but also all the technical and business solutions that we have tested and deployed. We think that is many new ideas that I know have inspired other cities, but most cities don't have particle accelerators. But there are many other heat sources that are available to use all around Europe. You have shopping malls, you have data centers, you even have a supermarket can be enough to heat somewhere else. And in Europe in total, we waste almost the same amount of energy that we use for heating. So if we can move the heat from where it's lost to where it can be utilized, we will gain a lot. But then it comes down to distribution. And that is what we are showing here, all the distribution of the energy.
Marcus, how does this project benefit those who live here?
It makes it possible for all the people that live here to get very sustainable energy without having to do anything in particular. It's very simple. Actually, the whole district is designed to make it sustainable life very easy.
Thank you so much for sharing your insights with us today, Marcus. For more insights, join the Enlit community.